Good evening, everyone. My name is Robert Gibson, the editor for the Australasian Carnivorous Plant Society, and
I'm Fuzzy, the treasurer, membership secretary, and general gopher, and do that guy. Do that.
So, thank you. Tonight we're going to give a brief presentation of a field trip we enjoyed doing last month to South Africa. We had 3 weeks travelling around in the Western Cape. So what I've done is I've put together some photos of some of the plants we saw, plus one or two maps as well, just to help paint a picture as to where we travel. We have a map of the Western Cape here. It's Cape Town in the southwestern corner, which is the main city in the Western Cape. So we're travelling within about 300 kilometres either to the east of Cape Town and also to the north. For the first week, we caught up with Stuart McPherson and one of the tour groups that he led, and there were about 8 people in that group. We basically took them, led them to some of the sites that I'd been to 20 years ago on my first trip to South Africa, when I met up with Eric Green, who sadly unfortunately passed away a few years ago, but he shared with me many wonderful sites. And then we also had the chance, Fuzzy and I, to visit some of these sites 11 years ago. So we've been to these sites up to 3 times over 20 years, so it's interesting to see how they have changed. So the first place we went to was Table Mountain, which is a peak that rises to about 1,100 metres, just above Cape Town. And it was fantastic weather-wise. This is a view from the northern part looking towards Cape Point and the...
You know what? I'm going to do it this way.
Okay. So it's an amazing plateau, which was Restios, plus some local Drosera. And as you can see here, it's got some lakes, which are freshwater reservoirs. And we're looking down towards Silvermine and Cape Point, Silvermine underneath the cloud there. And it was, it's a lovely place to be, and you can get to it so easily from Cape Town via a cableway. So the next slide. Shows a really beautiful Drosera cuneifolia, which is flat rosetted sundew, gets to about 8 centimetres across, very broad wedge-shaped leaves. It's endemic to Table Mountain and the sandstone range to the south, so it's a very limited distribution.
Close up.
It was described in 1753 by Linnaeus, so one of the first of the sundews to be recognised from the Western Cape, and it likes to grow in wet peat soils, and you see that in abundance in, on Table Mountain and also further south.
Yeah, it's high altitude thing, and when it does, that's when it gets huge, and I've seen a rosette about that wet across.
Flowers in the sunlight, it's cool, a few days later, and that's the site where you see Drosera regia. Now the weather was appalling, cold, wet, windy, and so some of the groups split and went to see Drosera regia, which was a 3.5 kilometre trek up a mountain valley. But the rest of us, ourselves included, stayed with the bus and just went up and down the pass itself, looking at some of the sundews. Now we've got the seeps on the side of the road. It's a little, very much like the Upper Blue Mountains, really lots of seeps with the Fuchsinia fern. And this is where you'll see Drosera capensis arrivals, which is a small sundew, very much like Drosera alyssiae. In fact, it was mistaken for alyssiae for many years. But the main features are north of Cape Town onto the edge of semi-desert to a place called Giftberg, which is a plateau, a sandstone plateau, the same sort of sandstone as we had on Table Mountain. And there you'll see around sandstone outcrops on the headwaters of small creeks, lovely patches of a rather poorly named Drosera alba. You think alba, think white. Yes, it has white flowers normally, but the leaves of the plant are blood red. They're just stunning.
Next.
So next, and this is a photo showing stand. So we saw the plants flowering, which was just fantastic. So the plants get to about 10, 15 centimetres tall. They've got a flat rosette with a number of semi-erect leaves, a little bit like Drosera filiformis. And then after those erect leaves come up, you start to get the flowers coming up to just 1 to 3 flowers per scape. Flowers about 1.5 centimetres across, and just a really beautiful species, and just found more in the more deserty areas of soil, growing in soil that gets sodden in winter and bone dry in summer.
The soil is anywhere from this thick to that. For the growing conditions, unlike the other other South African Drosera, where you're supposed to try to keep them in a pot and keep that dormant, or just a little bit moist. No, bone dry, put it out in the full sun, bake it royally. You know, let it get into 45 degree heat and just bone dry, and that's the only way you can keep growing them.
So it really is a plant that grows in extremes, but it's really beautiful to see. Not well known because it's not that common in cultivation, at least not at this stage, but it's certainly a highlight when you go travelling in South Africa in the spring to see this sundew in the wild. Okay, next. So I've got a photo of it just showing some of the open flowers. And yeah, it's also nice too, it's clonal, so once that's why you get the added effect, because you have multiple plants growing cheek by jowl together, and when you have the sun shining at a low angle behind them, they just glow with this lovely red colour, and they're beautiful to see.
Yeah, they are really red. Next.
Next. Another sundew that we saw a few different places, Alyssiae. So Alyssiae is, as I said, widespread in wet, peaty soil generally. Although it can grow in some of the wetter parts of the southern ranges, it can grow in some more drier soils. No flowers at this time of year, but just lovely rosettes to see, quite variable. It certainly is a species complex that does require a little bit more research to see what's going on within it, but it's certainly always good to see Alyssiae because it is a very pretty species. Okay, next. Another form. This is from 300 kilometres to the east, near the town of George. Rosettes are a little bit narrower in leaf, a bit finer. So again, it's just showing some of the variation within the species.
Yeah, the flower comes up from underneath and then loops up. So that's a typical key point for this year.
Quite a hook to the base of the scape.
Yeah.
Okay, next. And a dryland growing form of Alyssiae. This is a variety of Curva scarpa, which we saw in two locations on the south coast. Quite a pretty looking thing. Again, it has something that we see in some other drosera where they get that yellow-green pigmentation, and this really catches the eye when you see it growing in the wild, particularly when it forms some nice carpets in some areas. Okay, next. One sundew that I was particularly keen to see, which is your common garden variety Drosera capensis. We actually had two members of our group for that first week, some researchers from the United States who had actually been sequencing the genome of Drosera capensis, so they were keen as much to see it in the wild. And so we did see that it would feel like sites with them, but we also saw it when we were travelling the 2 weeks afterwards. So this is in Tradu Pass to the east of Cape Town, where the plants growing on the edge of this area that had burnt the summer before, and they were just glowing with the early morning light and looked very beautiful. Next. We were lucky to see to find a population of the alpine form of Drosera capensis too, and they were growing in just sodden conditions, as the photo suggests. The rosettes are far more compact, but they can have a very tall scape in the summer. But where they were growing, they almost looked like Drosera anglicum or Drosera senapetala with that habit. And it's just really nice to see, actually. It was, I'd seen it on two locations before, but this was, I didn't know about this site, just north of Ceres, but it's very easy to get to this site, which is a bonus compared to the hard slogs I've had to see this previously. So it'd be nice to go back and see how the plant goes over time. But yeah, it's nice to see this poorly known form of this species in the wild. And that's the habitat for that alpine form. It's going in the sea. The side of the lake at about 800 metres elevation.
Close up.
So just going over a very small area in a habitat that's otherwise very dry. It's a plant at Silvermine, so
yep.
That's one of the few sites where the broadleaf form grows. This wasn't the broadleaf form, but it had been collected not far from there. This is where we got research friends, and they were happy to spend an hour or so just looking at Drosera capensis that they knew well from their studies, but to finally see it in the wild, I think was quite a treat for them. And it's always nice to see it in the wild because it does surprise you with how variable it is, but also how well behaved it often is in the wild too.
Yeah, it does.
Accommodation. So another highlight, sundew-wise, Drosera cistiflora, which is a widespread and variable species. This is Linifolia, which was described by Paul Devitt, It often has small smaller flowers than the other plants, plus an ovary that's often green in colour rather than dark grey black. This is growing at the northern end of Bates Kloof, not far from Drosseregia. But yeah, just growing en masse, flowering at the time, on the time of our visit, which is great. And yeah, it's really nice to spend some time just seeing this very beautiful species growing so abundantly at this location.
Yep. Flowers.
Some of the flowers of Drosera capensis, sorry, cistiflora, which is very much like Corsiflora. This is a much, and this has the second largest flowers of any Drosera. Typically they're pink, but they do come in other colours like whites, dark purples, and also red. Sadly, we didn't see the red or the dark purple flower forms. They were either because of drought conditions, so they've already gone dormant. But it was good to see other forms of Drosera cistiflora, because it is a very beautiful species in leaf but also in flower. And one thing that you do notice is it has lots of beetles in the flowers. So beetles, monkey beetles are the main pollinator, but other sorts of beetles visit the flowers too. One thing they do is often they'll eat the flower parts. So they've always seen those pretty flowers because they've got holes bitten into them, but it just shows the interactions that you can get with these sundews and various invertebrates. We went to this site with our colleagues on the first week, and these sundews were a few days off flowering, and then we went back there the following week, and were fortunate to time it with them with open flowers, and the flowers were huge. They were about 8 centimetres across, very similar in size to the Corsiflora that grew downslope, very similar in colour too, and it was just, yeah, I'd never seen the plants there before, and it was just a really lovely display. Okay, so two colour forms of Drosera cistiflora growing side by side, of which the paler pinky purple one was the more widespread, with the dark pinky purple flower, or the darker purple flower was that. And red flower had been visited by another insect before and pollinated. So yeah, it's always good just to see what's happening to flowers. I don't know, they're pretty, but they're also quite dynamic with their interactions with
the and we can actually see here something cool too. If I go closer, you can see the star. See how it's been pollinated by the beetle. Completely, it's covered in that. But yeah, look at the stem. It's got glandular hairs. Yes. So in other words, it can trap bugs on its flower stems.
Another form of Drosera cistiflora that we saw, which has very broad leaves. This is variety multiflora. And it's a really lovely form of the species. The flowers are often white, can be pink. But the main thing is these leaves are just so broad. So it almost looks like Drosera hilaris in many ways, which grows in the same sort of habitat and same area.
Yeah.
Again, that's the pink flower form, which is not as common, but quite pretty, and that's a clonal group there that's growing in the fine boss.
In other words, it's one that's bred a couple of times, and they do that. And good when they're having a good year, they'll put out extra tubers, and from those extra tubers will pop up a new plant.
So nice, the flowers of the white form just to the west of Hermanus. So again, the flowers were a good 5 centimetres across, so quite substantial. So a nice addition to a very beautiful plant.
And they're not as finely divided in the stigma.
Okay, next. And another interaction we saw was flower spiders on the flowers of Drosera cistiflora. So that's in the Landscape Nature Reserve. And the spider's not as well camouflaged as others we saw, which tended to match the colour of the petals. It doesn't really matter, the spider was still able to effectively travel from time to time.
Closer in, the spider. So. And you can see the finely divided stigma, which is different.
The species, this is Drosera ericgreenii, which is a very limited distribution named after our late friend, Eric Green. This is very close to Drosera hilaris, which is a bit like a coarse form of Drosera capensis. One of the key features of this sundew is that the scape is woolly hairy. There are some other subtle differences too between hilaris, but this is only known from one single mountainside located allied to Drosera aliciae, but a rather large plant. It gets about 6-7 centimetres across. It can form a stem about the same height over many years.
It's an umbrella of dead leaves.
It's sort of taxonomic status has been a bit controversial. Some people think it's just Alyssiae. The flower structure tends to suggest otherwise.
It grows in dry cracks of the rock. It's really bizarre. It grows in places you would not think that ever to flower kind of as bryopes.
Drosophila bryopes, which is almost looks a bit like Drosophila madagascariensis, which is native to eastern, northeastern South Africa and other parts of Africa. This is evergreen to summer dormant. Forms stemmed up to about 40, 50 centimetres tall. And it grows through the wet fine boss on the south, on the ranges southeast of Cape Town.
Web rapies again, close up.
Which has a very finely divided stipule.
And it's very dewy and it's a voracious carnivore.
So this is Drosophilurus, which also is endemic to the ranges on the western southern part of the Western Cape. A bit like a very coarse form of Drosera capensis, but it grows on these dry slopes.
And it's really hairy.
Really hairy, very bedewed. It tends to grow year-round and have a summer dormancy depending on the conditions. Plants were just coming into developing scapes. We're about 4 weeks from seeing open flowers. But it's a very beautiful species to see. Scape doesn't have the long white hairs. And also it comes out at a different angle from the base of the stem as well.
And the Hilaris can be long, where there's greeny eyes are almost always more rosette. Here we go.
This is Drosera natalensis, which is very widespread in eastern South Africa, but I was keen to see it in the Western Cape, just to see how it compared. This is in the Tredu Pass, about 250 k's to the west, to the east of Cape Town. I knew it had been collected from there, and it took a while to actually find the plants, and there's a population of about 15 or 20 plants. This coming into scape, as you can see. It was good to finally see a plant that I knew a little bit about from my research and to track some plants down.
And it also likes bugs.
Yes. Growing fairly dry. The Porcifora, which has the largest flowers of any sundew.
Lovely Trinobia over there, I believe.
Yeah, so that's at private nature reserve. The rosettes, Porcifora get to about 8 centimetres across, or sometimes bigger. Very broadly wedge-shaped leaves, very hairy on both surfaces. I was really keen to just explore this place. I had no sort of solid leads, but we just followed the nose and found a population of Porcifora, which had white or pink flowers, and that's appears to be one of the white ones from the colour of the residual sepals.
And here we have,
and this is going back to the coastal ranges from Table Mountain and also Hermanus. You find plants of Drosera ramentacea. Now, ramentacea is very close to capensis in its form, but like Hilaris, like the bryopes, it grows on dry hillsides that gets the benefit of coastal sea mist. And so it's basically supplementing its moisture through the mist it traps on its glandular hairs, on its leaves. We saw this at the Warugula Gorgonia site that I'll show you more details or photos of shortly. The Slakii is a really beautiful species, particularly when you see large clusters of it. It likes to grow in very wet, peaty conditions in springs, and that's exactly where we found it. In this case, the plant's growing with its roots under shallow water, so that's why the leaves. The next photo shows a more typical shot of Slakii, with those lovely red leaves, with the swollen base, and also those very coarse red hairs in the leaf undersurface. One of the widespread sundews in the Western Cape, because it occurs in a wide range of conditions, from the dry hillsides right through to the sphagnum seeps. And another sundew that we saw quite often, which is nice, is Drosera ziaria, which is allied to Drosera flora. Some people think it's the same species.
Kind of a cross between them.
Yeah, the difference is that plants of Ziaria may or may not have stem leaves. The Sisiflora always has stem leaves, but if you add Ziaria to the mix, then it really
sometimes it does,
starts
sometimes
up
it
the
doesn't.
Definition of what is of Sisiflora. But we saw this pink flowered form of Ziaria in many different locations, and it's really pretty to see. And there are some photos of
plants of white flowered form too.
Yep, next. Yeah. So there's Plant and Flower, just near one of the big water supply dams in Cape Town. And yeah, the flowers are about 3 centimetres across, that lovely rich pink with that dark centre. And they've got very divine. And a nice open photo of azalea flower. Again, they're very pretty and very much similar to.
With little finely divided stigmatic
spores.
Yep, just like with the other two.
Okay, next.
Oh, Perugula.
So we saw Perugula gorgonis near Hermanus. This site had been burnt summer before last, so these plants were 18 months old or so. About 20 to 40 centimetres tall, and some plants flowered for the first time, others this was their second season because they just then divide after they flowered. And yeah, there were hundreds of these plants growing on this peaty wetland at this seat. I'd been there 20 years ago and seen plants at a very similar state because they'd grown after a fire. Some plants are killed by fire, but then the fire creates a seed bed on which the long-lived seed then germinates, triggered probably by the heat or the smoke or maybe both. So, and then over years, the plants thin out as the other shrubs take over it, but they can get up to about 2 metres tall before they flower, which is nice.
And it's in its own family too, isn't it?
Yeah.
Perugulaceae. So, strange odd flower and you get your own family.
So it's good to see that. And also to note how things have changed in the 11 years and 20 years since the previous visits. I see that many utricularia. There aren't that many native to the Western Cape. So this is the only photo I've got in this presentation of the utric, and that's the utricularia gibbo, which is the most widespread of the aquatic utrics in the world.
Yep.
Okay, so I'll just finish the talk there.